Ooh, did you hear the burp? I was trying to burp before I hit play or record. Okay, this time we're going to Nerdarchy. Seven have it. I can't even talk. Seven habits of highly effective D&D players. Habits of effect. Oh, okay. Highly effect. What is, first of all, what is a highly effective D&D player? Anyway, they got seven habits. They're going to talk about the seven habits of highly effective D&D players. Really?
Where we've already used or seen, you know, how that could be helpful in a D&D game. So habit number one, be proactive. All right, so you know, this is one of those things where I'm certain at your table, whether you're the GM, whether you're the player, you've heard the phrase, all right, well, what are you gonna do? What do you wanna do? It's
You know, actually, I've rarely heard that. I usually just make it up like it's like a common thing. But to be honest, I almost never hear that in games. Do you believe me?
is a good tool as a GM, but if you're a player,
What's with the third camera angle? We're watching crime TV. He's a witness talking about an unsolved mystery.
you don't need to wait for the GM to ask. You should have a list of ideas of things that your character wants to do. You know, do you have character goals? Do you have things that you want to see happen, make happen, whether it be
I wish these guys would use their own tips in their games for once.
you know, just go down and talk to that barmaid and, you know, see if you can get a date, or whether it's okay, I want to go find.
That's an interesting goal you have there. Talk more about this. Did he actually suggest a brief interlude of role play there between him and an NPC? That's gold. Any role play, if I see any role play from these guys, it's like gold. In a 6 hour game session of theirs, they role play for about 45 seconds. This guy does. Crap. This guy's just crap. He's just taking up a seat at the table. There should be a role play channel called Taking Up a Seat at the Table. That's what most of these channels are. I just take up a seat. I'm a bench warmer.
This ancient dwarven relic and restore power and fame to my family line. You know, these things are quests, great and small.
The way this guy plays, this guy over here, the way he plays is he pauses. He stays quiet for a long time. Because you can see him thinking. He's thinking for the right time, for the right time where he could use the thing he's been wanting to use all game session. And it's always at the weirdest time that he wants to pull out the thing and start doing everything to everyone. It's like, dude, what are you doing? Well, I have this thing. I have this new spell. I want to try it. I'm gonna try it he's always like in another time. What do they call it? He's out of sync with the other players most of the time. I don't know what he's thinking at the table.
And if you have these things, then you are going to be a better D&D player.
Yeah, it's real simple. You know, don't wait for your DM to drop plots on you. Go out there and look for the hooks and create your own.
You know, tip number two is begin.
Create your own. I would love to see this guy create his own hook for a change, ever. And do it without using Mother May I speak at the table. Can my character can my character climb over the fence into the neighbor's yard and look for buried treasure that he's heard the neighbors have? Just out of the blue, you know? How many dice are here? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. You know, technically you're supposed to have two D6s, not just one. Are these even in the right order? Where's your D3? Where's your D5? What the fuck?
Begin with the end in mind. How is this going to apply to D&D, Dave?
All right. At first, it doesn't maybe seem like it, but listen, hear me out. It comes down to two things, and they're both the same thing, essentially. And that's have goals. Have goals for your character and have goals as a player. And now,
oh, that's interesting. Goals as a player. I'm here to have fun. I'm here to kill stuff and chew bubblegum. Can you show me how to do either or? How many? Okay, here's a big D20 up here. This one's not so big. This one's big.
Sometimes this can be a little bit confusing for people to separate their player goals and their character goals, but a good example of that is, say you're a warlock who sold his soul, and then you decide it's a bad deal. Well, you picked the warlock class for a reason, because you wanted to play a freaking warlock. So does getting your soul back mean you can't be a warlock anymore? So the player may not actually want their soul back, but I think the character really would.
There's a lot of different things that are going to align here.
Okay, I see where he's going with his player goal. Oh, that's a big D6 right there. Anyway, so a player was the goal. I mean, I'll have goals, I suppose, as a player in a game session. But I'm in character, so I'm just thinking about, I guess my goal is to roleplay my character. That's my goal, as a player, is to roleplay my character. That's it. And my goal would also be to be active. Don't just sit there and listen to the other players and not say a word for 2 hours. My goal would be, I'm always doing something. Always. And then I would hope that the other, here's another huge D6 right here. There's the other players, you're hoping their goals are similar. They're there to roleplay. Everyone's goal is there to roleplay, right? In real life, when players show up to roleplay, they're showing up to roleplay. That's the player's goal.
There sometimes, as a player, it is amazing for your character to go out in glory, to have an
So, like, if players show up just to eat and talk out of character and to laugh and tell jokes and just hang out with their friends, kick them, flip the table. Do whatever you have to. Get a whole new group of players at that table. Start over.
Honorable death, to have something where your death is going to be so meaningful that, you know, players at the table, or, you know, that story is going to become legend amongst your kith and kin. So, no.
How often does that happen? Are you remembering it as a character, as an NPC character, or are you remembering it as the Disneyland storyteller reading you an excellent story that time? And you just sat there and listened to it all. That's a great story, GM. Thank you. Thank you for telling me the story.
Character is ever going to be like, I want to die. But as a player, that could be a cool thing. And I've seen it happen a multitude of times over the decades of gaming. So, yeah, having those things, I know there's definitely some tie-in between being proactive and...
It took him decades to see multiple times? Okay. Okay.
You know, having those goals. But, you know, when you start with where you might want to be in the end, that gives you the idea that you have a direction.
You guys play six-hour game sessions. You should be able to see all kinds of shit going on in your game in one game session. One game session. That's like two Lord of the Ring movies back to back, 6 hours. Oh, we did one combat scene for that. We did half of a combat session in that 6 hour session. What? We were in a hallway. And then we went to a courtyard. We fought the same things over and over repeatedly. I almost died like 4 times, but our healer healed us up instantly. It was a close call for all of us. Fighting in the hallway, trying to go upstairs. It was blocked by Atronachs and all kinds of things. It took forever. Our next session, we're going to still be on the stairwell. Yeah.
That you know where you want to go. Now, be prepared that things might change. You know, the story of, you know, my current long-term character in Dave's...
What's changing? What? What story? The written story that you're supposed to follow got changed? Or... Your character's not following the story? Are you guys making up the story as you play, like you should be doing? Are you trying to guess the story as you're playing? Are you... What are you guys doing? What? I'm thinking back to Gygax. Gygax was a terrible role player. He was garbage. He was a crap DM. The other guy, what's his name? Dave, what? Anyway. He was a normal dude. He could roleplay out of his head. He didn't have dice. He'd have 20 players at his table. I thought he was a pretty good dungeon master. I mean, for D&D, he was an okay dungeon master. He was okay. He was okay at it.
Game has definitely changed and skewed over the course of the game as things unfold. But it's definitely, I had an idea of where I wanted him to go. And, you know, you got to adapt.
So habit number 3 is put first things first.
All right, so how is this applying to D&D?
What does that mean? First things first? Okay, they don't do this habit. Okay, so these are good habits then? Okay, I thought these were going to be like 7 bad habits of highly effective D&D players. These are actually 7 good habits? 7 habits to have for highly effective D&D play. That's what the title should have been. So live in your character for like 40 seconds of your 6-hour game session. That's when you do the living in your character part.
Dave. All right, so really what this means for your D&D character and for you as a player is just be the character, live in that character. Try and think and experience the world through that character.
Couldn't that be like habit number 1, and basically the only habit you need to roleplay?
Eyes. Try and forget for just a moment that you're playing a game, that, you know, Dungeons and Dragons is a role-playing game, but instead...
Oh, the big lie. Oh, I should have a drink every time someone says D&D is a role-playing game. That's a drink right there. That's the big lie that these guys tell people. I've looked at D&D. It's still not a role-playing game. I don't see any signs of it ever being a role-playing game. But there's people out there saying, improve your role-play, improve, you know, and you watch the video and they don't say how to improve role-play, because you cannot. I've asked people, hey, do a video explaining how you can roleplay in D&D. And they say, sure, no problem. And then they don't do it. They won't do their video. I make it easy. Just say, a 5-minute video explaining how to roleplay in D&D. How to roleplay in character in D&D. And they're like, what? That's obvious. Anyone can do that. I say, well, make a video then. And they're like, oh, okay. Video, yeah, sure. And they don't do it.
Think of the role of your character. How do they interact with the world around them? How do they interact with the NPCs and other player characters in the game?
Well, the GM's not going to allow for that, are they? You know, the Dungeon Master's like reading a story of what the players are doing. I was watching a game last night. And the the person running the game was constantly telling the players what they were doing. The players weren't saying a word. Okay, you guys are all now going, heading out, heading into the city, going, you know, you're going through the gates, the guards, you know, you're high-fiving the guards as you enter the town, you know, what? What? The players are just sitting there for 10 minutes, not saying a word. Like, what the hell? What is this? Are the players in character? Are they totally immersed? Are they just sitting there being told a story about how awesome their characters are?
Be the character. You know, I know that there are times that as a role player, you really don't want to get into, you know, the nitty gritty of, oh.
Of what? Of what? What is he about to say? This guy who can't role play out of a paper sack. What's he about to say now?
Well, you know, how are you feeling today? What's going on? But there is so much more.
Driscoll, can you roleplay? Yeah, I can roleplay. Let's practice. I'll show you how I roleplay. And when it's. The NPC says something like, hello, hello, fair citizen. And I say back to them, oh, hi, Mark. You know, that's the extent of my role play. Banter is like one of the best things to do when you're role playing with NPCs. And players don't even know how to banter. They think role playing is, tut tut, it looks like rain. I'm a little black rain cloud, you know. This just Let me come to your tea party with my furry animals and we'll sit around and chit chat about the weather. To them that's roleplay. When you mention roleplay to these guys and that's what they think. That's what they think the scene's gonna look like. Nice night for a walk. What? And if you're not talking to the NPC, then there's no role play. Nothing. There's you're not role playing any other way except talking to the wench at the tavern. Nice set of glasses. Can I have one with beer or ale or something? Just lame dialogue, you know? To them, this is roleplay to these guys.
Attachment, so much more interactivity when you get into the actual building of relationships, you know?
Relationships? You guys can't relate with your own player characters. How are you gonna relate with what? NPC number one, come here. I need to speak to you for a moment. You too, NPC 2. These guys have contempt for NPCs. Contempt. They don't even talk to each other. Why would they talk to an NPC?
Into the actual characters. So when you begin developing connections, then the strength of the role-playing...
This is from, what, 4 years ago? Yeah, they've gotten worse. If anything, they've gotten worse with their roleplay sessions because they're monetized. They want to entertain. They want to be Critical Role. It's never going to happen. But the nerds, which there are an abundance of, they watch these videos because they're talking about D&D. Look at their bookshelf. Look. Is this Dark Sun? What is this one? Fading Sun or Dark Sun? I can't tell.
As a group is going to grow, and then if something detrimental happens to...
Look. Look at all the crap books they got. How much are these books each? How much money's wasted? Look. Crap. More crap.
Happens to one of those players, the impact is going to be so much more.
Habit number four is going to be win-win. But you know what? Before we get into that, I've got another win-win for you. And that's when it comes to what dice company.
All right. So I guess.
What is win-win? To me, this means building and strengthening the party dynamic. What's good for the party? That one sounds extremely dull. What's this one? Oh my god.
Oh, Dungeon no. Alchemist is an AI-powered map-making application that allows...
Everything we've kind of talked about.
I don't trust girls that smile while they're talking. Know what I mean? That's how they get that weird voice. So, this is when the whole party develops these habits. One person kick it off by... Oh, this is combat. That's all this is, combat. They know the routine. They've got their spells already. They know what order to do the thing, to kill the thing, and go boom, 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 one by one, kill off. And they just go across all the squares on the map, killing all the things in a certain order that works for them. What are they doing exactly? What's going on? Meanwhile, the dungeon master's like, "Oh man, I have to put more monsters on this map here. They're massacring everything." What's number seven going to be? Use combat combos, combo moves. Great combo! You know, get extra XP for the combo move.
Coming together and your party being able to work together. And in game terms, this might be, you know, using abilities that work well from different class features so that you can kind of create feasible tactics that just overall create great.
He's describing role playing right now in his mind.
Greater results than they would by themselves. For example, if players have the ability to give other players actions, like the Order Cleric does, Battlemaster can do it.
Mastermind
can do it. Well, anytime you can, like, give your rogue another opportunity to make an attack and make another sneak attack.
God, that sounds so gay. It's like anti-roleplay right there. What's this one? What? What do players do out of game? Are they practicing getting better at role playing when they're not in the game? Or are they just on their phone watching TikTok videos until the next game session? And then they're like, "What did we do last time we were here?"
Together and not overdoing anything. It's about downtime, really, inside of the game as well as outside of the game.
Downtime in the game? Oh, that sounds bad. We're all here. What are we going to do? I guess we're going to count XP and level up for the next 3 hours and decide what spells we're going to give each other.
Yeah, now, you know, we're looking at this one, and off camera, we were like, all right, how is this going to truly apply? And we realized that, you know, we've spent, you know, time where we've gamed numerous days in a row, and we know people who stream.
Okay, role players don't game usually more than once a week. Because what are you doing at that point? Quantity over quality? What are you doing?
You know, every day. And, you know, when you've got, you know, a job and, you know, house, the wife, the kids, the whole thing, it's really hard to manage time. But to...
No wonder you guys don't roleplay. Who has time for that? Okay, enough of this one.